My name is James Young, and I work in the Global Security Strategist team at Splunk. And today, or this morning, I'm going to take you through some of the key points around the Splunk integration with Amazon Security Lake and cover off some of the important points around the Open Cybersecurity Framework. So in terms of what I'll step through, first cover off some of the key points around the Open Cybersecurity Framework, which is a pretty important aspect when we think about Security Lake, given that that is the schema that's used by Security Lake. Talk a little bit about some of the Amazon Security Lake data sources and cover off external access to Amazon Security Lake itself and then how that relates to the Splunk integration. And then lastly, cover off a little bit about some of the key takeaways. So before I get started, as part of my role in the Global Security Strategist team, I've been working across many of the customers that have been previewing Security Lake since late last year and looking at the different ways that we need to integrate Security Lake and Splunk to maximize sort of the key use cases that customers are looking at. And obviously working through that process and really sort of a foundational area that's been pretty important and been a work that's been sort of underway by many partners, including the 16 key partners or 18 key partners that started off, was around the Open Cybersecurity Framework. So this is really a community-led effort to define a standard schema for logs or data, which is really designed to be quite an open, flexible, customizable, vendor-agnostic standard for data producers. So really the intent with the Open Cybersecurity Framework is not so much that we have a schema that we normalize raw data to, but more so a schema that we can start to have log producers natively support log formats as. But obviously one of the challenges around moving to a standard like this is that there's a period of time where we need to support transitioning from the old way of doing things to the new way of doing things. So there's obviously at this point various sort of states of support for OCSF and various different ways that partners or vendors are supporting the OCSF schema itself. So going back to the start of when OCSF was first being developed, sort of in the middle of last year was when the work really started in earnest. There was 18 founding members, obviously Splunk being one of those, working very, very closely with Amazon and a bunch of other members that you can see on the screen as well. And we're now looking at about 60 plus OCSF sort of community members that are working on defining the schema. As of sort of today, and the schema version that's been used by Amazon Security Lake is 1.0 Release Candidate 2, and that will evolve over time as sort of we extend the schema to support other kinds of data types and go from there. So really, OCSS, as I said, is a community-led collaboration across many vendors that's not owned by any one single vendor. Unlike some of the previous standards you may be familiar with, such as the Common Event Format or, say, the Common Information Model, Common Information Model being something that's very, very relevant when it comes to Splunk. And one of the other benefits is that there's a core schema that is defined, but it also enables extended schemas to allow for customization. So some of the challenges with, say, CIF or SIM is that if you customize that, it meant that it was very difficult to manage the process to upgrade to newer versions of those data schemas, but the OCSF schema itself allows for customization through what's called extended schemas. And this also enables you to use that schema or the OCSF schema itself for perhaps non-security use cases as well, so we can start to look at standardization of log schemas across other kinds of use cases outside of security. We can start to do enrichment of data as well too at the same time, so we can be ingesting data using the OCSF schema, and then we can also add additional context to that data as well. And the other key benefit as well too, which was really a big challenge with previous sort of standards, was that we have the concept of profiles, where profiles allow us to sort of combine multiple different schemas from within inside OCSF. So if we think about authentication or maybe endpoint data specific schemas, we can combine those using a profile where there may be a use case where we need to look at data across multiple different schemas itself. As I mentioned before, it's a growing, rapidly growing community. There's over 60 vendors collaborating on this at the moment, and it's rapidly gaining interest and momentum as we go through this process, which is good to see. And it's sort of really aiming to solve some of the key challenges that we have in terms of how we do data normalization. It's usually a big challenge when we're bringing data into data analytics solutions, or if you've been involved in initiatives to build a data lake or implement a data lake before, defining a standardized schema to sort of support ingestion of various different data types was quite a big challenge. So obviously a key sort of feature of Security Lake itself is that it is all based upon the OCSF schema. So at the moment, say with the GA version of Amazon Security Lake, which was released May 30, there's really native support for several key AWS data sources itself. So we're looking at CloudTrail, VPC flow logs, Security Hub, Route 53, and also some capabilities around Lambda logging as well. There's early third-party support from a few key vendors for OCSF, and many of them aren't necessarily using native capabilities to generate logs in a raw format using OCSF, but in the early stages, they're using a couple of different mechanisms to maybe transform to OCSF to get data into Security Lake. So if you're familiar with Security Lake at all, it's absolutely a requirement that the data must be in an OCSF format to bring it in as a third-party source, and also that it also needs to be wrapped up in a Parquet file to be ingested into Security Lake as well too. So really, vendors that are looking to integrate as a third-party source with Security Lake need to support both the OCSF schema and write that as a Parquet file as well. Now, when we start to think about Splunk and accessing the data in Security Lake, there's really, from an external subscriber perspective, so a subscriber is someone that has access to the data in Security Lake, there are two key methods of access. The first being what's called data access mode, and that's the first level of integration that we'll cover off from a Splunk perspective. And I'll talk through in the coming slides. The second mode is what's called data query mode, where we can run ad hoc searches against the data as an external subscriber of that data that's stored in Security Lake. So think about the two probably main use cases there. One with data access mode is to ingest or read all of the data as it's going into Security Lake and writing that to maybe something like Splunk. Whereas data query mode is more for ad hoc investigations, ad hoc searching of the data that is stored within Security Lake itself. With data access mode at the moment, there's only the ability to select specific data sources. So if we're thinking about the native AWS data sources that are stored in Security Lake, there's really only the ability to turn on access to specific data sources. So we can enable access for an external subscriber to specific data sources like CloudTrail or VPC flow logs, and they will ingest all of that data as data access mode. So there's no ability to filter what data within a specific data source by data access mode at the moment. Whereas data query mode, we can obviously write searches to look for specific sets of data. Now, in terms of Splunk specific support for ingestion of data from the Splunk or the security data lake itself, at the moment, the first level of integration, or stage one integration, if you like, is the ability through the AWS add-on for Splunk. We've introduced support in version 7 to include support for data access mode into Security Lake, which enables us to ingest or read and index all of that data that goes into Security Lake, either across the board for all of the data sources that are in Security Lake or for specific data sources based upon the configuration of the external subscriber that we have used for the integration there. So really, we can only select all or some of the data sources that we will read, and we will index all of that data into Splunk. The way that works is we monitor the Amazon Security Lake SQS queue for all writes going to the S3 bucket that Amazon Security Lake is using. We decode the Parquet files and then ingest that as OCSF JSON into Splunk, and then obviously index that for searching or use later on. Now, OCSF data itself is not natively supported by Splunk Enterprise Security. If you're familiar with Splunk Enterprise Security, it uses the common information model. So all of our detections, all of our monitoring dashboards, all of that capability that's in Splunk, and enterprise security is based upon the common information model, and obviously we use that for data normalization, but also acceleration of access to those that data. But what we do provide, or will provide, is a way of mapping OCSF data back to the common information model. So in the short term, we have a way of using OCSF data that we've ingested either from Security Lake or other sources with Splunk Enterprise Security. So all of the out-of-the-box capabilities you have with Enterprise Security will work with that OCSF data. So that add-on will be released and published on Splunk base for customers to use in the coming weeks. Now, going beyond that, the next stage of integration that we will release in the coming months is the ability to support query mode access to data that is stored in Amazon Security Lake. So if we think about the sort of two use cases again, one is to ingest and index that data and make that data available natively in Splunk for use. The second mode may be we don't want to ingest certain kinds of data, perhaps VPC flow logs, for instance, is a common one that we don't necessarily often use for threat detection, but you may need to use for investigations. In the coming months, we will release support to be able to run ad hoc searches from within Splunk to the Security Lake data to find sort of interesting data that you might need to support your investigation. So without necessarily indexing and ingesting that data, it will be available using federated search for S3 and running searches against an external data store there when it comes to Amazon Security Lake. So really sort of summarizing and putting it all together, or putting Amazon Security Lake and Splunk together, one of the things that we sort of want to think about is what data needs to go where and when. So increasingly, from a Splunk perspective, if we're looking at things from enterprise security and threat detection and threat monitoring, there's going to be common data sources that are going to be more relevant to the threat detection side of things versus what we might use from an investigations point of view. So commonly, I'm seeing a lot of organizations that are focused on maybe building coverage around MITRE attack, which is probably going to be heavily focused on data sources like endpoint data sources, using that, ingesting that into Splunk to build coverage from a MITRE attack perspective for your threat detection, your real-time threat detection and monitoring use cases. Whereas data like VPC flow logs probably has less value from a threat detection perspective, maybe more relevant from an IOC matching or subsequent investigations perspective. That's something that might make sense to keep in the Security Lake and then use that via federated search for ad hoc investigations after the fact from a threat detection perspective. Longer term, we're looking at different ways that we can build what we're calling a data tiering strategy, where we can use Splunk features such as ingest actions or edge processor to route and filter what data goes into Splunk versus what data may go into, say, external data lakes such as Amazon Security Lake. And that way we can be selective on where that data is stored, and then we can start to use features like federated search to search those external data stores. One of the advantages, perhaps, in the short term with the current integration that we have is that now, whereas if you're familiar with how we might typically ingest all of the different AWS data sources, there's many different inputs that you need to configure and many different ways that you would need to bring that AWS data into Splunk. With the Security Lake integration, it's one input we can configure to ingest all of that AWS data into Splunk that will come in the OCSF format. Then we obviously provide, if you like, backward compatibility with OCSF for SIM, using that Splunk add-on for OCSF to SIM. And I think the other consideration that's important as well is right now there is really varying levels of support from third parties for the OCSF data schema, which means not many third-party sources will have out-of-the-box support to be written directly to Amazon Security Lake. So many of those data sources may need to still come into Splunk until there's support for OCSF and being able to get that directly into the Security Lake. So that's pretty much it in terms of what I wanted to cover. For any questions or to see a demo of the current level of integration that we have with Amazon Security Lake, please pop by booth 128 and we'll be happy to show you the demo and cover off everything that we have and talk about some of the things that we'll be building in the future in terms of supporting Amazon Security Lake and OCSF as well. So thank you very much. Enjoy the conference.